I'm honored to be here. Let's try that again with Frank Berliner on Walk the Talk Show. And I understand you have a book coming out. What's that about?
I do. My book is going to be published in 2 weeks, actually.
It's exciting.
First day of spring, which feels very auspicious.
Uh-huh.
And the book is called Falling in Love with a Buddha.
Uh-huh.
And the book is about my experiences with my spiritual teacher.
Okay.
And
Who was this?
His name was Chögyam Trungpa, and he was the founder of Naropa.
Naropa
University that I attended that summer that you were born,
right,
when it first started.
Right.
And for the last 18 years, I've been a professor there.
Uh-huh.
So my connection with Naropa has gone back a very long way.
Uh-huh.
But it's really based around, originally around my connection with my teacher.
And where did you meet him?
I met him at Naropa,
in
Boulder,
that
in
summer.
June and July of 1974, for the first time.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Okay. And then you went on to be, like, you were the head of all the Shambhala meditation training thing, right?
I was.
Mm-hmm. So you got super involved. So why did you like this guy? Were you looking for a spiritual teacher?
I was not looking to become a Buddhist. I'm still not looking to become a Buddhist. It's just a label. I was drawn to him because of his personal qualities. I had never met anybody like him before. Incredible stillness, relaxation, mm-hmm. kindness. Devastatingly sharp awareness and perception of his students.
He was infamous for, like, pulling the rug out from underneath.
He was. And in fact, in Tibet, he was a Tibetan teacher.
Mm-hmm.
In Tibet, the style of teaching that he had is known as crazy wisdom.
Uh-huh.
So he was deliberately, he would deliberately shock in order to wake people up.
Right. He tried smoking pot. LSD,
drinking.
He smoked on stage, he drank
he
on
did.
Stage.
And sometimes, once he was asked, why do you drink, he said, sometimes it is necessary to insult in order to communicate. Because everyone had preconceptions
right.
about what a spiritual teacher is.
Right.
And he was not interested in conforming to those expectations of a spiritual teacher being this holy man, as you say, sitting on the mountain with the white turban.
Mm-hmm.
He felt that actually that there was a lot of dishonesty in spiritual teachers coming to the West and taking advantage of Western students' naivete and fascination with that whole Oriental mysticism.
Right.
And so
people forget, but like in the late 60s with the Beatles and all that, it became almost like, you know, people, instead of having a poster of Michael Jordan on their wall or whatever, they would have a poster of some spiritual teacher.
Yeah, Maharishi.
Right.
Or the Beatles would go to India with Maharishi. So spirituality and drug culture and the
right.
liberated sexual culture and all those things were happening at the same time.
So how can we bring that sexual freedom back? Let's just talk about that. No. So you were...
I think that's very much of an individual decision.
Yeah. And the interview took a turn.
Yeah.
So this book is...
So let's get back on track.
Yeah. It's like meditation. You're bringing me back. So this book is about your relationship with Trungpa.
It's about my relationship with Trungpa, and maybe I could say a little bit about how the book would develop.
Mm-hmm.
Being his student and being in his presence was always a very powerful experience because he was very awake and very unpredictable.
And by awake, you
awake,
mean?
I mean that you, when you encounter other people, you're basically mostly involved in playing a game of presenting your personality.
Uh-huh.
So we're all
were
playing
you saying
this.
Me personally?
I'm
yeah.
saying all of us.
Yeah, okay.
All of us are. My personality is talking to your personality.
Yeah.
He had no interest in that level of personality. He was interested in the deepest sense of who are you authentically as a human being, and I will help you find that out. And sometimes helping you find that out was extremely embarrassing. In other words, it was a process of being unmasked. And at the same time, there was tremendous kindness and compassion. So the combination of that sweetness and compassion and that devastating sharp accuracy was something that I had never encountered before, and I've never encountered it since.
And why were you you were attracted to that? Because you felt like it would make you a better person?
No, because I felt that this person was totally awake in the way they were living their life. They were living life with the fullness that I wanted to live my life.
Hmm.
And that by studying with such a person who was this genuine, that I could cultivate and connect with my own genuineness more and more, and then I could teach other people about that, and my whole life has been based on that. So it was a tremendous inspiration. But what I wanted to say was that the book that I wrote, he's been gone for 25 years. On April 4th, in about 3 weeks, it'll be 25 years since he died.
Huh.
And the book has been kind of gestating inside me ever since he died. All these encounters I had with him, all these experiences. And I wanted to get them down on paper while I could still remember them.
Right.
And so the book has been a process of gradually getting all that down on paper. And in the while that was happening, my own father passed away. And my father was a very powerful influence in my life as well. And I began to realize that there were many stories about my relationship with him that I wanted to tell, and also the fact that he encountered Chögyam Trungpa a number of times. And I wanted to talk about that as well. And so eventually the book became more about fathers and sons, as much about fathers and sons as about teachers and students.
So what's the name of the book?
The book is called Falling in Love with a Buddha.
Right. And so can you share a story or two from the book? That...
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I first saw him at Naropa. I didn't get a chance to meet him personally. I just heard him give meditation instruction. And I went to his classes, and I was very drawn to him because of his genuineness and the beauty of the way he taught meditation. And I went back to my home in Vermont, 2,000 miles away, and then learned that he had a meditation center only 60 miles from where I was living. Huh. And I ended up moving there.
And to Karmichilin.
To Karmichilin. It was called Tail of the Tiger in those days. Mm. And when I first moved there, he came there four times a year to teach. And the first time he came in the fall of 1974 was my first opportunity to meet him one-on-one. And so I guess the brief story I will tell is about meeting him for the first time one-on-one. It was at the end of a long seminar he did, and the sense of anticipation of actually meeting him personally kept growing in me. And they had a picnic at the end of his time there, just the day before he left. And at that picnic, it was quite a boring picnic, but at the end there was a receiving line, and each person who had gone to the seminar who wanted to could go up and say hello to him. And so I had built this up into this huge thing. What can I say to him to show that I understand his message and that I'm going to be a really great student and he should really right. think what a great student I'm going to
right.
be.
You
so the
be
line
like
keeps shrinking, and I keep watching, and he's just sitting there very, very still, very still. Finally, it's my turn. My mind is moving like a, just moving like a top, back and forth, back and forth. And I walk up to him, and I'm trying to think, what am I going to say? And just as I come up to him, before I can say a word, he says, "Don't try so hard." Mm-hmm. Which totally stopped my mind. And so I just stood there. My mind had completely stopped. And I tried to think, what can I say now? But all I really wanted to do at that point was just look at him. And then he says to me, "More." And I said, "More what?" He said, "Relax more." Huh. So then I tried to relax. And I hoped that he would touch my hand and say, "Yeah, you're a good student now, you know."
Yeah.
He just looked at me, and then he nodded his head and he said, "Okay, goodbye." And that's when I fell in love with him.
Huh.
I fell in love with him because he saw me more clearly and deeply in a moment than anyone had ever seen me in my entire life before. And because I saw him do that with everyone that he encountered, and I saw him do it with love and with the intention of helping us grow up and become real human beings, I had never encountered anything like that. And I felt it was important for me to tell that story because it happened in different ways over the whole time that I knew him until he died. So my book is full of stories like that.
Well,
that's basically what it's full of. These almost cinematic, vivid moments of encountering a Buddha. By the way, the word Buddha simply means somebody who's completely awake. That's what it means.
Right.
Has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with being awake. And meditation is a way to help us wake up that way. It's completely ordinary. It's an art. It's not a religion. And we can all use it. And it's very helpful. It's quite good, actually.
It's good stuff.
It's cool. Quite good.
Jolly good. So, yeah, I mean, you've learned well because I come meet with you every couple weeks, and when I do so, you just look at me with kindness and a lot of spaciousness, and I freak out in my mind, and then I relax a little bit, and then you're like, "Get out of here." So,
yes, well, that's the lineage.
Yeah.
And
right.
I look forward to when you're going to pass that on
yeah.
to the next generation.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'll have to get off coffee, but thank you. Frank Berliner.
Thank you, Ben.
Jolly good show.